This is Carrie Ballinger. I work for Teradata Technology and Innovation Office, and I am delighted to be here today to share with you some of my perspective on Teradata workload management for enterprise platforms. One of the things about enterprise systems is they often support a diverse collection of different types of work, all active at the same time. You may have different types of loads happening at the same time as your analytics, along with query and reporting, some batch jobs, and then some very critical customer type dashboard queries. Often these demanding users want resources at the same time, so there's room for conflict and contention here if they are unmanaged. And that's where Teradata Active System Management comes in. This feature has its roots in Teradata's history, came into being probably 15 or 20 years ago, and it was architected specifically to meet the needs of platforms that are diverse in their workloads and that do have contention for resources and are supporting important SLAs. It offers a number of different priority buckets that you can assign to the work. It gives you the ability to manage poorly behaving queries or queries that you don't want to run at certain times of the day. It also lets you automate setup changes when different things become important at different times of the day. So I want to cover each of these just lightly in our session here today. But let's look first at something that's very important with Teradata Active System Management. And I'm going to use the abbreviation because it's so easily pronounceable, which is TASM. TASM is workload-centric. And what I mean by that is each of those different diverse workloads that we looked at on the demanding users slide, when you set up TASM, you would typically give them each their own workload, and you would start off by listing those different workloads and getting agreement within the company that these are the priorities or the relative priorities of this different work. For example, on this chart, we have our production data load. We make a note of when it's going to run, and it's a night job, and whether it has an SLA or not. And then its relative priority compared to the other active work on the platform. And so we go through all the different types of work and we note its relative priority and if there's any SLAs. A lot of workload management in Teradata is oriented towards protecting the high priority work that has an SLA while at the same time making sure there's adequate resources for the less critical but still important work that needs to be completed. And this kind of a chart is a first step in that direction. Once you have identified these different workloads and their relative priorities, the next step is to place them in a priority hierarchy. And there is a GUI tool that allows you to easily do that. This hierarchy is oriented towards servicing the workloads placed near the top before servicing the workloads placed further down in the hierarchy. So there are predefined tiers that make it easy for you to put your high priority work at the top. There is a tactical tier, which is given an extremely high priority. Any work that you want to run in a couple of seconds or sub-second even belongs in that tactical tier. And then we have a service level goal tier, which is for high priority work, where you can actually assign a percent of resources that you want allocated to that particular workload. And then at the base, there is what we call the timeshare tier, and that's composed of four distinct priorities. This is the work that's important to the business, but doesn't have a clear SLA associated with it. And what happens in this priority is if a high priority work, like the CFO dashboard, which we're giving a 35% allocation, it's unlikely to need that much resource consistently throughout the day. But that's what we're giving it as an entitlement. And anything it doesn't use immediately flows to the other workloads below it in the hierarchy. So there's always allocation that's unused from the top of the priority hierarchy that flows down to the bottom. You can add another level at the top of your hierarchy, which is what we call virtual partitions. For instance, you might have your headquarters business and then two business units that are important, but you want to control how much resources they're allocated. You want to make sure that your headquarters gets the majority of resources. So in this case, we create a priority hierarchy just for the headquarters virtual partition, and the whole partition will get 60% of the platform resources. And then the business units get a smaller percent, and within those business units, they can have their own priority hierarchies that will draw from that virtual partition percentage that we've assigned. And again, if one of the business units isn't using its allocation, then that will flow immediately to the other virtual partitions proportional to their allocation percent. So you can get very granular in your priority assignments with the TASM workload management approach. Now, there may be cases for certain workloads you do not want to enjoy the benefit of unused resources from workloads that are more important. For instance, you may have a data labs workload or a workload for data mining or some kind of exploration, and you want to make sure that it's never going to get more than 10% or 20%. And you can do that by placing an option called a hard limit on the workload or on a virtual partition. And in this example, we've got a workload that's sometimes using a lot, averaging about 20%, sometimes using less. And we want to limit it to no more than 25% at any point in time. And so we do that by putting a 25% hard limit on the workload. The workload is still going to consume the same amount of CPU at the end of the day, or I/O at the end of the day, but it's going to stretch out further in time because we're limiting it to only a certain percent at any point in time. So this is a way to guarantee that certain workloads, however resource intensive they are, will not be allowed to interfere with other active work. Another option that gives you a similar kind of control is called a filter rule. And these are not widely used, but they certainly can help you, under certain conditions, prevent very resource-intensive queries from even getting started. Here is a system filter rule, for example, that I've seen used at a couple of Teradata customer sites. It's a rule that prevents any query that wants to scan the call detail record table from executing between the hours of 8 a.m. and 5 p.m. Now, typically a call detail record is something used by a telco, and it's very, very large because it holds every call that's made within that provider. And so we'd like people to access it at busy times through indexes, more efficient way of accessing it rather than full table scans, which read every single record. So this filter rule will examine the queries entering the system, and before they begin executing, it will reject them if the query meets the criteria you have specified when you set up the system rule. So this can be useful, again, in protecting more important work and preventing the system from being consumed, or the resources in the system from being consumed by queries that are more appropriate to run at different times of the day. Concurrency control is probably the most popular option within Teradata Active System Management. There are many uses that I have seen customers of Teradata make using what we call throttle rules. Typically, an enterprise platform is going to have an irregular pattern of concurrency. It's a little bit like the traffic flows on the highway. You can sort of predict when there's going to be a lot of concurrency, and sort of predict when there's not. They're somewhat unpredictable, and there tends to be peaks and valleys. And so what these throttle rules do is allow you to control how high those peaks get. And this is a way of protecting, again, the more important SLA defined work. so that we can see it become more consistent. Because of the usefulness of the throttle rules, over the years we have added different variants of throttles, different types of rules. The system throttle rule is the one that we originally brought into being in the TASM feature, in which all you have to do is set the criteria that you want the system throttle rule to follow, and all queries with that criteria will fall under the control of that throttle rule. When you define a throttle rule, you give it a limit. And it could be one query, it could be 20 queries, it could be 50 queries, whatever matches your particular business requirements. There are also user throttles where you can specifically assign a throttle just to one user and limit that user to maybe one query at a time or two queries at a time. You can also have collections of users that are under the control of a throttle. And then each workload, if you wish, you can have a throttle on, limiting how many requests will be allowed to be active or how many load jobs will be allowed to be active. The theory of throttle rules is that if a query would cause the throttle rule to exceed its limit, it's placed in a delay queue. It will eventually run, but only when one of the active queries in that category complete. So you're just delaying its unset. You're not rejecting the query. Now, we talked a little bit earlier about the filter rule, which examines the characteristics of a query that's about to begin execution and then rejects the query if it matches the criteria defined in the filter rule. This workload exception rule that we're discussing on this slide is somewhat similar, but it's a way to take action on a request that's already running. Maybe it's a request that looked perfectly reasonable, but it might have been, for some reason, the way it's executing or characteristics that were not able to be identified before it started executing, it began to become a bit of a problem query. It's consuming large amounts of CPU, for example. You may want to act on that query, and there's different acts that you can take. This is all automated once you define the workload exception rule. Workload exception rule, you have to set a threshold. You have to decide which queries in the workload are going to qualify based on that threshold. In this case, our threshold is the query in this workload has consumed over 2,000 CPU seconds. Then you have to define an action, and the most common action is just to change the workload. Move it to a lower priority workload, one of those workloads in timeshare, for example, so it won't get access to as much resource as other queries in that workload. You can also abort the query if you want, or you can just simply send an email to the DBA or log an exception. So this is also fairly widely used among Teradata customers as a way to manage very resource-intensive queries in an otherwise reasonably high-priority workload. Workload patterns of behavior often change from day to night to afternoon to weekend, and your business priorities often change as well. For instance, at month end, certain reports may become critical to your business to get done quickly, or year-end processing may take a big priority over the things that normally get prioritized during the workday. You can set up multiple states in TASM, and you can define what triggers that state change. On this slide, we're looking at a simple state change example based on time of day, where during our day state, we have the dashboard applications, the CFO dashboard, and the customer app dashboard get very high priority, and the load work gets a low priority. And some of the lower priority work may have stronger throttles that hold back that work more completely during the day. And then during the night, we want the load work or other batch work to get a higher priority, and some of the dashboards and querying to get a lower priority. And that can be set up. Once it's set up, automatically when a certain time of day is hit, the workload management setup will change. And you can make these state changes based on just running a job. We call those user-defined state changes. You can also have a state change based on system conditions. If CPU utilization reaches a certain 99% or 98% or 95% maybe, you might want to make stronger throttles on your low priority work to hold some of them back and to take a little pressure off the platform. Or if you lose a hardware component, you might want to make your low priority work less high concurrency. So there's a number of options you can do, but state change is again, a very widely used option in TASM. So we've talked about quite a few different workload management options in a very high level. And you can use TASM for very simple things if you don't have wide and complicated needs. But if you do have complex mixed workloads, TASM is a great answer to help you be successful in protecting your service level goal workloads, meeting the varied needs and the changing needs with hundreds of different possible priority buckets at your disposal. And you can also have more control over what runs, when it runs, and most importantly, how much of it runs at any point in time. I think the most important thing is the business requirements can be very well represented in workload management with Teradata. And we know that business requirements change, so TASM is oriented towards ease of change, ease of evolution, and ease of growth. So this protects your investment going forward, as well as giving you a well-performing balance system today. In closing, I'd like to thank you all very much for joining me in this discussion of one of my favorite topics, Teradata Active System Management. This is important for Teradata Vantage. Workload management is one of the primary underpinnings for the success of the Teradata Vantage platform.